Hello, and welcome to today's Laker Lesson, part of the Research into Action series, where we bring you important information from research that you can apply to your everyday life in schools. I'm Venessa Keesler. I'm an educational consultant working for the Grand Valley Charter Schools Office, and today's topic is school climate and staff satisfaction. What are we going to cover in today's lesson? We're going to focus on the relationship between school climate and culture and staff satisfaction and retention, and we're going to look at some evidence-based strategies to improve school climate and culture. And I have exciting news about today's Laker lesson, today's Research into Action. We are using a piece of research that has been conducted by the Grand Valley Charter School Office in coordination with Basis Policy Research, called Examining Teachers' Perceptions of School Working Conditions, Analysis of Fall 2022 School Operations Survey. And this is part of an important series of surveys that the Grand Valley Charter School Office conducts, looking at school climate, teacher satisfaction, other important factors. This survey is conducted multiple times a year. So it's really exciting to be able to talk about research done on you, about you, to inform your practice. And it is also exciting that Grand Valley Charter Schools Office provides these important regular research-based check-ins for the Laker learning community. So what do Grand Valley teachers have to say? As I mentioned, this is the most recent of a series of survey analyses. And just a little bit more about the study, it is teacher survey data, and it's done on K-12 schools who are authorized by GVSU. Going to tell you a couple of the key findings, and then we'll dig in a little bit deeper. So there's a lot of good news in this survey. 82% of teachers surveyed were satisfied with being a teacher in their school. And 55% of schools in the Grand Valley Charter Network have what are called favorable working conditions. And Basis Policy Research measures this by looking at a number of items on the survey that relate to working conditions in a school. So they create a composite measure and then divide it into favorable or unfavorable levels of working conditions. So 55% of schools said, we think our schools have favorable or better working conditions. Another key finding was that this will not be a shock to anybody listening, but developing strong professional connections with teachers positively influences overall satisfaction. So when teachers feel connected with leaders, with others in their school, they feel more satisfied with being at their school. And finally, the relationship that schools establish with parents and guardians positively influences teacher satisfaction. So again, those are the main findings from the survey, but we want to talk about them a little bit more. So let's do some unpacking of the relationship between school climate, staff satisfaction, and retention. If school climate helps with teacher retention and satisfaction, then what helps with school climate? And I want to take a minute and say I'm using staff satisfaction and staff retention somewhat interchangeably because satisfied staff are more likely to stay in the school where they are. So while this looked at staff satisfaction, we're also interested in the relationship to retention. So what helps with school climate? There's four big things that we're going to talk about in greater detail after this. The first is leadership that listens, forms positive relationships with staff, and understands curricula. The second is time to teach and form relationships with students without disruptions. The third is time to collaborate with peers around instructional topics. And the fourth is strong parent and guardian engagement at the school level. Let's take a look at each of these in greater detail. There are a few findings about school leadership that the school operations survey brought to light. And I've already mentioned the first one, but I want to talk about it a little bit more. Having meaningful professional relationships with teachers is an important part of improving school culture. I just want to take a minute and address any school leaders who are watching this. If you're watching, you might be thinking, wow, you're probably going to tell me a bunch of things that I know I should do and I want to do more of them, but I don't have a lot of time. It is hard to be a school leader these days. And I know that is the case. And I know with safety concerns and student behavior, there's a lot going on for you as a school leader. What I hope that this can encourage you about is that there's too many things for you to do and not enough time. So as you're prioritizing, here are some research-based, some evidence-based places to prioritize. And one of those is those professional relationships with your teachers. School leadership that specifically engages teachers in the decision-making process. So again, you're coming up against a decision, any kind of a decision. Look for opportunities to engage your teachers. That helps improve the relationship between leadership and teachers and improve school culture. School leadership that hosts informal instructional conferences. So a lot of attention has been paid about evaluation, instructional walkthroughs, all of those. But that regular informal feedback around instruction, around the curriculum, those help improve relationships and strengthen the relationship between leadership and teachers. Again, this next bullet I feel like is one we all hear all the time, but it's so important. Providing that meaningful and actionable feedback. So feedback about what's going well and feedback about what can improve. And then conversely, feedback is a two-way street. So receiving feedback from your teachers, from ancillary staff in the building, from others, considering it, and being transparent about how that feedback will be used for improvement. So it's not just saying, thank you for the feedback, I'll think about it later. I'm saying, thank you for the feedback, I've thought about it, and here's how we can use that to help us get better as a school community. And again, these are all things coming out of the school operations survey. So a couple key facts from the school survey that might be interesting to you. When teachers feel school leaders know their instructional strengths and their areas for growth, they're more likely to report that they like how the school is run. So there's an association, a correlation between saying, I know my leader knows what I do well and where I need to improve, and I like how this school is run. Similarly, when teachers feel comfortable raising issues or concerns with school leaders, they are more likely to report being satisfied in the school. So on the survey, when the teachers who answer, yes, I'm extremely comfortable raising issues with my school leaders, they are also more likely to report that they're satisfied with their school environment. Second thing about improving climate, disruptions matter a lot. So if you have been watching a lot of research into action series, we talk about disruptions in another research into action. Teachers are interrupted very, very frequently, and this has a big negative impact on not only academic learning for students, but on teacher satisfaction and school climate and culture. So one study of a large school district on the East Coast estimates that a typical classroom is interrupted more than 2,000 times per year, and that those interruptions and those disruptions cause a learning loss, a loss of instructional time, let's say, between 10 and 20 days. So that's time that teachers aren't able to teach. It's breaking their concentration and frustration. And interestingly, this was a finding from a national study. And then we see the exact same feedback coming from the Grand Valley School Operations Survey. Teachers who reported experiencing less frequent interruptions, they also reported higher satisfaction and a greater degree of agreement with how the school is run. So it plays out right here. Your teachers are saying, please, if I could have fewer disruptions, I am more likely to be satisfied and I'm more likely to agree with how this school is run. Collaboration and time with peers, that's a big thing that matters as well. Again, we unpack this relationship in another research into action, professional learning and instructional coaching. Spending time with peers and collaborating with peers helps make professional learning more effective, and it also creates a positive environment for teachers. Roughly 50% of teachers in the Grand Valley survey reported that their collaborative and individual planning time is sufficient, which means that 50% think it isn't. So that suggests this is an area for improvement for the Grand Valley charter schools. And finally, in terms of the relationship between schools and parents, the Grand Valley School Operations Survey shows that 95% of teachers who report active parent and guardian engagement at their school also report being satisfied with being a teacher at their school. On the other hand, only 63% of teachers who report less active engagement say that they're satisfied with being at the school. So that's a big gap in satisfaction based on this, the level of engagement with parents at the school. I wanted to take a moment today and think a little bit about some practical suggestions. Some of these are spelled out in the Grand Valley School Operations Survey report, and some of them come from other places in the research. So leaders, this is now the third time I've said it in this research into action, so I will just continue to say it is important for you to prioritize relationships with teachers and staff. If you have only a little bit of time and you have three things you can do and one of them would build relationships, research suggests that doing that thing is a good use of your time. Engage in professional education about giving feedback to your staff. So keep an eye on the Grand Valley Charter Schools Office Professional Education Catalog. Look for other opportunities. There are really popular methods of feedback out there. There's lots of training courses. So be honest with yourself. Are you good at giving feedback? Do you know how to give constructive feedback? Do you know how to give instructionally based feedback? And if you're like, well, I could improve, seek out some additional training, because again, time that you invest in becoming better at giving feedback will pay off in terms of improving your school climate and culture and in terms of improving academic outcomes for your students. And then I want to expand a little bit on the idea of ask your staff for feedback and listen to it. So I'll be honest, this is a practical tip that I've used for many years as a leader in a large environment with many people who I was responsible for leading. I led a team of about 250 people for 7 years. This was one of my favorite things to do, and it really had good results. So I would email all of my staff, and I would say, please respond privately, and please give me one thing that I'm doing well, just one, and then give me one thing to work on. Because as a leader, I'm thinking, I am sure you can find 10 things I could do better, but I can't improve in everything all the time, and I also need to be able to process this feedback in a meaningful way. So give me one thing I'm doing well, because who doesn't like a little bit of encouragement, and then give me one thing I can improve on. And then I would compile all that information, and I would share a summary of it. You know, I would obviously de-identify it or take out things. I'd share themes. You know, you all would like more communication from me, and you would like me to be more real. That was a piece of feedback I received as a leader. Be more authentic. Show us your real self. So I would say, this is what you said to me, and then here are the action steps. We're instituting a quarterly all-staff meeting, and I am going to share at that meeting both about the work, but I'm also going to share about myself personally. And we instituted more regular communications, email communications from me to all staff, as opposed to me communicating to directors and managers, so people could hear from me more regularly. I'm not saying this was a silver bullet or perfect, but this was a process that worked really effectively, and I'd be curious if you might want to try it in your schools. People really appreciate being asked for feedback, and they really appreciate it when you ask for feedback and then do something based on their feedback. That greatly increases relationships and a sense of satisfaction and community among your team. Okay, so this is obviously a research into action presentation, and so data is a big deal. Data is a buzzword. Everybody wants data, and there is a role for school climate data always. I'm going to skip to my don't before I go back to the do. Don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good in terms of data. Don't get caught up in massive data collection efforts. Don't try not to go too far down the rabbit hole of school climate surveys or whatnot, because everybody who is in this world on a research angle has their own climate survey that they think is better, that's based on their framework. It's overwhelming even for somebody like myself who's more in the research world. And I would think as a practitioner, you'd be like, could somebody please just tell me which survey to give? And in that case, I can tell you which survey. So Grand Valley does the school operations survey on a regular basis. And the more of you who take it as teachers, more of your teachers who take it, the better data you'll get about what's going on in your school, in your district, and in the Grand Valley Charter portfolio. So the next time you see something hit your box about your inbox about, oh, take the school operations survey, that's your chance to get really good data without a lot of extra work on your part. And then, as I already mentioned, asking for feedback with informal methods like a short survey or an email, that is fine. Think formative feedback. That's what you need as a leader. That's what teachers need with their students. It's okay if you don't have a, you know, 80-item school climate survey that you give every 2 weeks. In fact, that would be a terrible idea and would ruin school climate. So please do not do that, especially. Reduce disruptions. The more I look at this from the research, the more convinced I am that this is a huge area for improvement and something that schools could feasibly do. So small changes to logistics that minimize class instructional time disruptions could have a really big impact. One of the suggestions that comes from the literature, Grand Valley Charter School Office, the School Operations Survey brought it forward, is basically to sit down with your teachers, again, engaging teachers in decision making, sit down with your teachers and ask them to identify interruptions in their day, or ask them for a week to track the interruptions or something. Do some like a little bit of data gathering. Get them together and say, what kind of disruptions did you have? Oh, the office called, a student came to the door, somebody came late, there was an announcement, there was a fire drill, like whatever. List out all the interruptions, and then say, which of these could we do differently? Could we have rules about when announcements are made? They're only one time a day. Could we have rules about classroom visits and calls to classroom phones? Other rules. Your teachers are great experts. They will know what is interrupting their classroom, and they probably have an idea about how to fix it. Or if not, you guys can problem solve together, and that will have the double benefit of reducing disruptions and improving school climate and improving relationships with your teachers. I would love, if you do implement this, I would love if you would reach out to the charter school office and say, we are going to try to reduce disruptions. I would love to track this to see people who try this on the ground and if it helps over time, because all the evidence suggests that it would. So teacher collaboration time was the third big thing. And again, on both of the time, making more time, time is hard. There's not enough time. Believe me, I feel that every day. So what are some practical things you could think about? The first thing I would say is have an attitude of yes. I have seen school leaders, teachers, principals, superintendents many times over the years say, well, I'd love to change X, Y, and Z about the way the school day is run, but I just can't because of pupil accounting rules or because of my authorizer or because of this rule or that rule. And there are a lot of rules. I'm not going to tell you that education is lacking in rules, but there is more flexibility than you think. And so approach it by saying, we want to prioritize more collaboration time for our teachers, like set a goal. Call the Grand Valley Charter School office and say, can somebody talk this through with me? What are some ideas? Call your pupil accounting manager and say, we want to do this. Is this going to work? What would work? What wouldn't work? In fact, anytime my standing suggestion, anytime you're doing anything with time, instructional time, your pupil accounting manager, if you don't know who that is, find out, should be on speed dial. They will help you. They would, believe me, they would much rather help you ahead of time and have you get it right than have to find it in an audit. That's a lot of work and hassle and pain for everyone, including them. So call them up and make them a partner early on, and they'll help you navigate the sometimes Byzantine world of pupil accounting. And then think about creative staffing solutions. You know, we have a very like one teacher for one classroom for 1 hour or one day model in our heads, but there are a lot of other solutions out there. The MDE Office of Educator Excellence has put out a number of resources on this, and same thing, pick up the phone and give them a call. They would be happy to brainstorm with you because they want this too. They want better teacher collaboration and more time for relationship building and instructional improvement. And then I already said the don't just assume this is impossible because of seat time. And definitely not because of standardized testing. If you make improvements to the school climate, if you make improvements to teacher satisfaction, if you give more instructional time, it will show up in your standardized tests at some point. It just will. Good instruction shows up in standardized testing. We have done too many bad policy decisions at every level, state, local, federal, because of standardized testing. So let's stop that now. Let the tests be the diagnostics they're meant to be and focus on the right choices for your teachers and students. And finally, parent engagement. It was very interesting to me in the Grand Valley School Operations Survey to see such a strong relationship between teacher satisfaction and parent engagement at the school level. Although not surprising when you really think about it, you know, engaged parents help teachers do their job better, and feeling like the school is building those good relationships is critical. One of their suggestions from the school operations survey is to participate in professional education opportunities on parent and guardian engagement. They point out that a lot of people actually haven't been trained on what is good, you know, what are some good ideas, what works, what doesn't. So keep an eye out for offerings coming from GVSU Charter School Office. Collaborate with parents and guardians on engagement strategies. Whenever you're unsure of the best way to get somebody involved, calling people in and saying, we want to get more of you involved, is sometimes a great place to start. So asking parents and guardians, what would help you get engaged at the school? Why don't you come to certain things? Can you help us develop an event? Hosting regular office hours for parents and guardians. This was also an intriguing idea. So just saying, these are the times when the school leader is available or these teachers or whatnot, where parents and guardians can call or email or come in or whatever the format is. So people don't feel so like it's so hard or there's barriers or they're wasting time of the school leader to come in and talk about things that aren't important enough. You know, I think we tend to default to parents come in when it's discipline. But wouldn't it be great to have parents and guardians involved just because they want to know what's going on in the school and how they can help? And then providing an ongoing forum for teachers and families to engage in dialogue on quality education. And this was the distinction from, you know, there's parent-teacher organizations and things like that. But really making sure that there's time for teachers to talk about what quality education looks like and families to engage in that conversation as well. And to share different perspectives on it. You know, we can get, I think those of us who've been in education a long time, and I'm including myself into this, I can get a picture in my head of what good education looks like. And it's good to hear from other perspectives about what, you know, what they're experiencing, what's working and what's not, other points of view on what should be included in a well-rounded education. And that's it for this Research into Action. Thank you.